Welcome. My name is Jackie Higgins. I'm the chair of the stewardship committee for the San Diego chapter of ASLA. And we're lucky enough. For those of you that haven't been to our events before, our mission is to create awareness and to help advance sustainable and environmental landscape practices here in our local community. So with that, I'd like to introduce Rich Reisner. He's our president of the San Diego chapter of ASLA this year, founder and landscape extraordinaire.
Greetings, everybody. Thank you for coming. First thing I want to ask is if everybody has a cell phone, just put it the ringers off. So we have some important speakers, but you can keep your phone on in case an emergency comes up. Just please answer it and head out the doors. I appreciate that. I just want to thank everybody for coming. These events are great. Our stewardship committee does an excellent job coordinating all this stuff, taking time away from their busy schedules and family life and work. So actually, a round of applause for our stewardship committee. And if they could stand up. There's a couple, and there's some important stewardship people. So thank you all. You guys do a great job. We couldn't do this without you. Secondly, our sponsorships are super important. We have two great sponsors for this event, Bellegarde and Hunter. Thank you both. I know you're back there, one of them. And there you are. Thank you for the food today. And there's still plenty of food left, so help yourself after the event to get more. We appreciate that. We also have other sponsors in the room. We always thank you for your participation with all our ASLA events. I noticed some faces in here from our sponsorships. We have a great Ruby sponsor this year with TB Pinnock. We always want to thank them. They've really stepped up for us this year. So with that, I'm just going to turn it over. Yes, Michelle? Yes, thank you. Most importantly, for where you're sitting today. We appreciate that. I want to bring up a couple of other events that are coming up. We have our lecture series with Amelia, and I don't see her here, but our next lecture is April 21st. We have our design awards on June 9th. We also have our golf tournament, and if any of you don't know what that is, you should actually go to the golf tournament. It's an amazing event, and that's September 19th. So please keep those events in mind and enjoy the event. Thank you all.
All right. Thank you so much, Riz. Rich. Mic drop. Okay. So there's going to be about three different parts of our event today. There's going to be two presentations, and then we're going to have a question and answer panelist session. So I'm going to introduce our speakers. First, we have Ken Kozik with Fusco Engineering. Ken is the project manager with Fusco, and he has been with Fusco Engineering for about 12 years. He has designed, managed a wide range of projects, including residential, commercial, and public works. His specialty is in hydrology, hydraulics, and stormwater treatment. And then our second presenter today will be Chris Rosink with Hunter Industries. He's in the back there. Chris has been with Hunter Industries for about 15 years, and Chris specializes in the managing the specifications for Hunter, as well as being their face to the public for San Diego. And he's also sponsoring the event today, so thank you, Chris. And with that, I'd like to introduce Ken. All right, take it away, Ken.
All right, hello. Thank you very much for having me here today to talk about the new stormwater permit and the BMP design manual. Sorry, I'm not used to using a microphone. Let me know if it gets too quiet or too loud. So as Jackie mentioned, I've been with FESCO for about 12 years now, and over that time, stormwater requirements have changed quite a bit, and it's become a bigger and bigger part of what we do as civil engineers at FESCO Engineering. And I'm sure it's become a bigger and bigger part of what you guys do as landscape architects. Some of these stormwater treatment facilities are part of the landscape as well. So today I'll be talking about the latest generation of stormwater requirements and how that will impact future projects. So here's a quick overview of what I'll be talking about today. First off, what are the MS4 permit or the stormwater permit and the BMP design manual? Then I'll talk about some of the major changes in these documents from previous regulations. There's several changes, but the main categories are under water quality treatment and hydromodification. Then we'll talk about how these changes might affect upcoming projects and then offer some solutions and planning tips for when you're looking at new projects and how to integrate these stormwater requirements into the project design. So the stormwater permit or the MS4 permit is issued by the Regional Water Quality Control Board. So the state of California is split up into regional water quality control boards. We're in Region 9, which covers most of San Diego County, basically San Diego County from the ridgeline of the mountains to the west, and then also portions of Southern Orange County and Southern Riverside County. Now the MS4 permit stands for Municipal Separate Storm Sewer Systems. So it's an M and then four S's. It's also sometimes referred to as the stormwater permit. And so this is a permit that the regional board issues to the county and the cities within the region, and it allows them to discharge from their municipal stormwater systems into the waters of the state.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but it turns out we've got an overflow crowd, so we need the people on the side there to please exit. They're going to open the doors in the back so that we can accommodate everyone. And I do apologize for the interruption. It'll be noisy for a few minutes. I don't know if you want to just stop or continue through.
I'll keep going in the interest of time. But let me know if you can't hear, and I'll speak up. And so previous MS4 permits, the MS4 permits are renewed every 5 to 6 years. The latest one was adopted in June of 2013. And it covers all of Region 9. Previously, the different counties within the region had been on separate permits, but this one includes the San Diego County, Southern Orange County, and Southern Riverside County as well. And you may be wondering, well, if it was adopted in June of 2013, why are we still talking about it? The permit had a timeline for implementation that included that outlined some documents that needed to be prepared for the to be implemented, and that includes something called water quality improvement plans that were looked at each watershed to determine the highest priority water quality concerns for those watersheds, then a document called the watershed management area analysis, and also the BMP design manual. Now, the BMP design manual is what we use as civil engineers to design our projects to comply with the terms of the permit. So that's kind of the most important document for us as civil engineers, and that kind of trickles down to landscape as well for those areas of overlap. Per the timeline outlined in the permit and following an amendment, the BMP design manual was implemented in February of 2016, so just last month. On the 16th or the 26th, depending on your jurisdiction. And the BMP requirements. There we go. And the BMP requirements in the BMP design manual primarily apply to priority development projects. And so I'll talk a little bit more about what those are. Is that better? No? Okay. I'll just lean over. That's okay. One of the first questions we're asked by clients and developers when there's a new requirements going into effect is, well, can my project be grandfathered under the old requirements? So to talk a little bit about grandfathering, the permit originally didn't include a clear definition on what projects would be grandfathered, but through a series of workshops and an amendment to the permit, a definition was included into the permit. And so the permit refers to grandfathering as prior lawful approval. So in order to be grandfathered, under the old requirements, your project had to have prior lawful approval before the effective date of the BMP design manual. And so that effective date is February of 2016. And so in order to get prior lawful, to qualify for prior lawful approval, the projects had to meet a couple of requirements. And those include having an approved design of the storm drain system, including the stormwater treatment BMPs, been issued a construction permit. So it could be a grading permit or a building permit, but any sort of permit that authorized construction. And so those two both had to happen by February of 2016 in order to be grandfathered. And then further, the project had to begin construction within 180 days of that date. So basically you have to get your permit by February 2016 and then begin construction within 6 months. And then for phased projects, they can retain that grandfathering as long as all subsequent permits are pulled within 5 years of the effective date. So basically, unless your project has a permit already or is part of a larger phase project that has had permits pulled, your project won't be grandfathered and will need to comply with the new requirements generally.
Can I get you to put this on? That way it'll be easier for you.
Okay, is that...
Right here?
Yes. Can you hear me? Okay, good. Okay, so now we'll talk about the priority project definitions, because these did expand under the new permit to include more projects than were previously included. So there's a few different categories. So in order to be a priority development project, it includes a new development which creates 10,000 square feet or more of impervious area. Redevelopment projects which create or replace 5,000 square feet of impervious area. And then for certain types of development, that 10,000 square foot threshold is reduced down to 5,000 square feet. For projects that include restaurants, hillside development, parking lots, streets, driveways, auto repair shops, and gas stations. And then if you're adjacent to or drained to an environmentally sensitive area, that is threshold is reduced further to 2,500 square feet. So for most projects, you know, which typically include a parking lot or a driveway of some sort, the threshold for being a priority development project is 5,000 square feet of impervious area. And so if you're a priority development project, then you need to comply with the design requirements in the BMP design manual. Okay, so now we'll talk about some of the major changes in the new MS4 permit. And it kind of falls into two main categories. As I mentioned before, water quality, or the new term for that is pollutant control, as well as a hydro modification. So first we'll talk about pollutant control. So there's some new concepts in the pollutant control section of the BMP design manual. One is called the design capture volume. So this is the storm volume that we have to capture and treat per the permit. And this used to be, we used to think of it as the first flush rainfall event, kind of these small frequent storms that produce the most pollutants. And so the design capture volume, or the DCV, is sized based on the 24-hour 85th percentile storm event. So what that 85th percentile means is that 85% of all storms are that size or smaller. So if you capture the design capture volume, you're theoretically capturing 85% of all storm events in the region. And to give you an idea of what kind of volumes we're talking about, the 85th percentile storm event in downtown San Diego, for example, is a little over half an inch of rain. And it varies throughout the county. It generally goes up the closer you get towards the mountains and the farther north you go. So for example, in San Marcos, it's about 0.8 inches of rain. So it's a fairly sizable volume of water that we're talking about. And in the calculation of the design capture volume, it takes into account things like your site area, the runoff coefficient, your percent of impervious areas, and there's also, and your soil type as well, and there's also some reductions that are available through certain site design features, such as impervious area dispersion. So if you disperse your runoff into landscape areas, if you have enough, if you do that enough, and there's ratios that you have to comply with, you can get a reduction in the design capture volume and therefore in the size of your BMPs by doing that. Other reductions can be had through green roofs or permeable pavement, because those are basically treated as pervious areas under the BMP design manual, because they allow for infiltration or absorption by the soil. And there's also a reduction through tree wells, because it's been recognized that trees can intercept rainfall prior to it hitting the water, or prior to hitting the ground, and thereby reduce the amount of runoff. So you can reduce your design capture volume in certain cases by taking credit for the amount of trees you have on site. So you may have civil engineers start to come to you and ask for how many trees are on your site, which they probably weren't interested in before. So once you calculate the design capture volume, you have to decide what to do with it. How do we treat it on the site? And the permit and the BMP design manual kind of outline, I like to think of it as three different tiers of treatment. You're supposed to comply with like the highest tier, essentially, that is feasible for your site. And if not, then you can step down to the next tier. So the top tier and the preferred method of treatment is on-site retention. So the idea of on-site retention is to implement LID or low-impact development BMPs to retain 100% of the design capture volume on your site. Now the term retain means that it can't leave your site, so you don't have any runoff from the design capture volume size storms. And so if it doesn't run off your site, you have to dispose of it on your site somehow. And so the way the methods the BMP design manual outline as possible methods are infiltration into the soil or reuse on your site. And there's some feasibility criteria within the BMP design manual that allow you to assess whether or not it's feasible for your site to implement retention BMPs, infiltration, or reuse BMPs on your site. Now, unfortunately for San Diego County, a lot of our sites don't have very good infiltration characteristics due to the geotechnical conditions. We have a lot of clay soils or shallow bedrock, steep, large cut and fill slopes that geotechnical engineers don't want any infiltration near. So in a large percentage of projects, infiltration will most likely be infeasible, but there will be some few sites where that is possible and where that's the preferred method for disposal of the design capture volume. And that determination will likely require coordination with the geotechnical engineer as well to determine what the infiltration rates are on the site, may need infiltration site-specific infiltration testing, and determination of any other geological hazards to make sure that infiltration is feasible on your site. Now for reuse, the BMP design manual talks about two main reuse options. One is for landscape irrigation, and the other is for toilet flushing, indoor reuse through toilet flushing. And there's, again, feasibility calculations in the BMP design manual to assess if it's feasible to do either of these options on your site. One caveat is that the BMP design manual instructs that the design capture volume should be able to be used within 36 hours after a rainfall event in order for it to be feasible to reuse. And the reason for that is that, in the winter, some years where we get, storm event after storm event a couple days apart, they want that design capture volume to be disposed of before the next storm comes along so that you can capture the subsequent storm as well. So there's a 36-hour guideline for you to be able to dispose of the design capture volume on your site before the next storm event comes. So you probably realize that there's not much landscape irrigation demand within 36 hours of a storm event. So in So for a lot of sites, landscape irrigation, capture and reuse will not be feasible because there's not enough landscape irrigation demand within 36 hours after a rainfall event. Now, if you still want to do a capture and reuse system for irrigation to reduce your water usage and, you know, possible lead credits and the like, you can oversize your stormwater capture system to be able to make that happen. And similarly, for the toilet flushing, the BMG design manual wants that volume to be used up within 36 hours. And so the stormwater volumes are generally rather large, and then toilet flushing volumes are rather small. And so we've tested this out on a few different project types. For most projects, it would show infeasible to be used within 36 hours. The types of projects where we're running into it, where it might be feasible, are mid-rise and high-rise projects, where you have a relatively small footprint project and a lot of toilet demand. So in those cases, it could pencil out to be feasible for capture and reuse through toilet flushing or other indoor uses as well. Okay, so that covers kind of the retention tier. So if it's infeasible to do either infiltration or capture and reuse on your site, then the next preferred method is to implement biofiltration. So biofiltration is kind of a slightly new term for what we typically have thought of as bioretention basins or flow-through planners, rain gardens, those sorts of BMPs, which we've been seeing for several years now. So it's not an entirely new concept. There are some new sizing requirements for biofiltration based on the design capture volume calculations. And the good news is in that some cases the sizing can actually go down. Like the old rule of thumb for the minimum size of a biofiltration or bioretention basin was 4% of the impervious area on your site. Under the new BMP design manual, in many cases that can be reduced down to 3%. And a new concept or a new option on the table under the new stormwater permit is the concept of alternative compliance. So alternative compliance is kind of like off-site mitigation for stormwater. So the idea is that you still have to do some degree of treatment on your site. So you implement flow-through treatment control BMPs on your site and perform an off-site alternative compliance mitigation. So I'll talk a little bit more about the alternative compliance option. The idea is generally that it's off-site water quality or hydromodification management projects that offset the impacts due to your project on-site. And the idea is that it provides a greater overall water quality benefit to the watershed than if you simply implemented the permit requirements on your site. And so the county and the other co-permittees have developed water quality equivalency criteria that allows you to calculate essentially how much off-site mitigation you need to do to offset the impacts to your project. And that calculation considers factors such as land use and pollutant loadings and BMP effectiveness, both of your on-site project and the location of your off-site alternative compliance project. And eventually, there'll be two options for alternative compliance. Either the project will be able to construct it themselves or contribute funding to a regional alternative compliance project. The applicant-initiated alternative compliance can be proposed now under the BMP design manual and the water quality equivalency criteria. But the credit and fee-based systems are still under development. And our best guess is they're another 1.5 to 2 years out. And I think that's going to be an attractive option for a lot of developers, but again, that's probably 1.5 to 2 years out. The applicant proposed alternative compliance projects, we haven't seen any of those come through yet. Curious to see how it works out, because there are some hurdles as far as maintenance and such to determine how that will work out. Okay, so that basically covers the major changes under the water quality portion. So now we'll talk about hydromodification. First off, what is hydromodification? It's still a relatively new term, so not everybody's familiar with it. So hydromodification is increased erosion in soft bottom streams and channels as the result of development. And these impacts have been attributed to increased flow magnitudes and durations on small to medium-sized rainfall events. So if you take a natural site and construct a project on it, add some impervious surface, you know, roof or parking lot or pavement, when it rains, you're going to have higher flow rates, and those flow rates are going to last for a longer period of time than they would in the existing condition. And that can cause erosion and degradation of the downstream channels. And so the idea of hydromodification mitigation is to keep channels at the top looking like the top and not like the picture at the bottom. And so the rainfall events of concern are from a percentage of the 2-year storm up to the 10-year storm. So it's the small to medium-sized rain events that cause the most erosion within channels. So under the pollutant control and water quality considerations, we're looking at these small, frequent rainfall events. For hydromodification, we're looking at the small and medium-sized rainfall events. And of course, we as civil engineers also have to look at the peak storm event, the 50-year or the 100-year storm event, to ensure there isn't flooding. So really, we're at a point now where we have to look at the entire spectrum of rainfall events to make sure there are no adverse effects. And one thing to note on hydromodification is that there are some exemptions available. Projects that, including projects that discharge directly to the ocean, bays, or major rivers, particularly the lower section of major rivers, those are generally exempt from hydromodification impacts because the idea of hydromodification mitigation is to protect natural streams and channels. So if your project doesn't discharge to a natural stream or channel, then you don't have to protect it. So if your project discharges directly to the ocean, you're exempt from hydromodification. And the way you do hydromodification mitigation is to basically detain water on your site and release it at a slow, non-erosive rate. So it leads to larger BMPs generally. So the major changes under the hydromodification requirements, there's two main areas. One is that mainly impacts redevelopment projects, and that's that post-project flows under the new permit must not exceed pre-development flows rather than pre-project flows. Now that may sound like semantics, but pre-development means before the site was ever developed in the first place. So this means for redevelopment projects, there's no longer a credit for existing impervious areas. So under the old permit, a project could get credit for existing impervious areas or potentially even be exempt from hydromod requirements if they were reducing the overall imperviousness of a site. But now that exemption is no longer holds, and you don't get any credit for existing impervious areas. And so that means that redevelopment projects must implement flow controls to match the conditions of an undeveloped site. So this means larger BMPs and larger detention systems potentially for redevelopment projects primarily. So another change in the new requirements under hydromodification is the introduction of something called the protection of critical coarse sediment yield areas. So this is a new concept that was introduced in the permit. And the basic idea is that naturally occurring sediment is beneficial to receiving streams and beaches. So under natural conditions, a certain amount of erosion occurs within the upstream reaches of a watershed. And that erosion, that sediment that's generated, is deposited in the receiving streams. Some of it makes it down to the beaches and replenishes the beaches. And so in order to maintain an equilibrium in these streams and channels, you have to maintain those sediment-producing areas. And so the county and the co-permittees did a regional mapping effort to identify where these critical coarse sediment yield areas are. And it's generally areas with coarse soils, so like sandy or rocky soils, and then steeper areas that will generate erosion during a rainfall event. And then they also considered vegetation cover, because certain vegetations allow sediment to pass through while others capture it. And so if these critical coarse sediment yield areas are present on your site, They must be either avoided or mitigated. Some good progress was made in the final months of the development of the BMP design manual to develop a mitigation strategy for critical coarse sediment yield areas. This is one of the last pieces of the BMP design manual to fall into place, and I'm really glad it did. The mitigation calculations focus on showing no net impact to receiving waters. So if you're impacting these critical coarse sediment yield areas, essentially what you need to do is detain more water on your site, so you're reducing your erosion potential as well to offset that loss of sediment. So with that, I'll show the map. So this has sometimes been referred to as the RASH map. So this is the kind of regional mapping effort of the critical coarse sediment yield areas throughout the county. So as you can see, it impacts, there's a potential impact to a lot of the undeveloped areas of the county. The good news is, through development of that mitigation criteria, it's potentially manageable for a lot of projects. And the county has also linked this requirement to their RPO steep slopes ordinance. In the county, if you're complying with the RPO steep slopes requirements, they consider that compliance with the critical coarse sediment yield areas as well. So there's a couple good options that have been developed for managing these critical coarse sediment yield area impacts. Okay, so now I'll offer some solutions and types of BMPs that you might be seeing on projects to implement these design requirements of the new permit. So under the retention category, there's basically two options, capture and reuse or infiltration. Capture and reuse can be through irrigation or indoor, such as toilet flushing reuse. Infiltration BMPs can take quite a few different forms. Bioretention basins without a subdrain, so a true bioretention basin that retains the water within it and allows it to infiltrate, is considered infiltration BMP. So if your soils can accept that infiltration and you don't need a subdrain within your bioretention basin, that can qualify as infiltration. You can also have infiltration basins or infiltration trenches. Underground vaults can be designed with an open bottom to allow for infiltration into the soils below. And then dry wells could be an option for some sites as well that have a relatively small footprint and can infiltrate water into the soil below. So under biofiltration, you can have biofiltration basins, which we've been seeing on a lot of projects the last few years. These can also be constructed above ground and above ground planter boxes for more urban projects. And potentially proprietary high-rate biofiltration units. These are units such as Filterra or Modular Wetlands. That the BMP design manual kind of left a door open for these to be implemented in certain circumstances. It's kind of left up under the up to the discretion of the jurisdiction, though. So it's not like you're going to be able to propose these on all projects and they'll cover you. I think it's only going to be in certain circumstances where you're really constrained on what your other options are. If you're doing alternative compliance, you still need to do some level of treatment on your site. So things like downspout filters, hydrodynamic separators, media filters, kind of the old school black box treatment devices that we used to use quite a lot, but they don't quite cut it anymore unless you're doing alternative compliances as well. Okay, now some examples of these in the field and some design, some notes on them. So biofiltration basins, the general idea is there are shallow depressions in the landscape area that are designed to capture runoff, allow that runoff to pond, and then filter through soil media below. Typically there's a gravel subdrain layer. If you can infiltrate, then you don't need a subdrain. If you can't infiltrate, you do need a subdrain generally, and sometimes an impermeable liner as well. In many cases, the geotechnical engineer requires an impermeable liner as well. And the reason this is one of the preferred treatment methods in the BMP design manual and the MS4 permit is that it's effective for a wide range of pollutants. It's very It incorporates natural cleaning processes and does a good job at removing pollutants. And these basins can be easily incorporated into the landscape areas of your site, parking lot islands and edges, streets right away, potentially in the parkway strip along a street, or in the median if you have an inverted crown, and then landscape areas around the building as well. Then to give you some idea of rule of thumb sizing for these units, if you have to do water quality treatment and hydro modification, the size can vary from about 6 to 16% of the impervious area on your site. The reason it varies so much is that there's several factors that go into come into play when you're determining your hydromod requirements, such as soil type, slope, and you can do something called a channel assessment to look at your downstream receiving channel and see how susceptible it is to erosion. So that's why there's such a big variance there. And if you're doing it for treatment only, say if you're exempt from hydro modification or you're dealing with your hydro mod in some other way, then the footprint of these biofiltration basins can be reduced to about 3% of the impervious area on your site. Now, another potential solution that we may be seeing more are detention vaults. These can be pretty flexible depending on how they're designed. They can be configured with retention. If your site allows for infiltration, you can design these with an open bottom so that the vault would capture the runoff and then slowly infiltrate into the soil below. Or it can be used as a cistern with a reuse system for either landscape irrigation or indoor reuse. And it could be potentially integrated with biofiltration as well. So if you can only provide 3% of your site for biofiltration, but you need to do hydro modification as well, you can do the treatment within the 3% biofiltration area, and then do your hydro mod storage in an underground vault to reduce the amount of surface area that you need to use for your BMPs. So the detention vaults alone do not provide pollutant control treatment. So it needs to be done in combination with either retention, infiltration, or biofiltration. The bonus of these is that they can be installed under other surface improvements. So you're not devoting portions of your site solely to stormwater treatment. And it can be installed under parking lots, streets, or landscape areas to allow you to maximize your property usage. And then as some rule of thumb sizing for a typical 4-foot deep vault, the footprint of that vault for hydromod storage would be about 2 to 10% of the impervious area on your site. Okay, now some tips on how to plan for a new project to make sure these stormwater treatment components are integrated into the site. First off, consider your timeline. Will the project be subject to the new BMP design requirements? Most likely, yes, unless it's already permitted or part of a larger phase project. Check for hydro modification exemptions. Like I mentioned, the redevelopment exemption is no longer available, but if you discharge directly to the ocean, the bay, or one of the major rivers in the county, you may still be exempt. I think projects are going to need to involve the geotechnical engineer quite a bit more early on in the planning process to determine if infiltration is feasible for the site, and that may include infiltration testing on the site. Look at your opportunities for reuse. Do you have a large landscape area where you could use the irrigation water? Are you going for LEED credits? There are some LEED credits available for stormwater reuse as well, so those may be factors that push you towards doing a capture and reuse system. Is alternative compliance worth exploring? If you have a very constrained site, that may be a good option for you. And it's going to be increasingly important to identify the stormwater strategy early on and integrate it into the site planning efforts so you're not finding out down the road that you need to devote 16% of your site to a biofiltration basin. Nobody wants that to find that out later. And it will allow you to account for BMP costs in your site development budgets early on as well, because some of these features can be quite expensive as well. Okay, so that's it for my portion. Thank you very much for having me. My contact information is up there on the screen. Feel free to reach out with any questions you may have, or should I open it up for questions now? Or
yeah, we can take a few questions. We have plenty of time for that, but then there will be a larger question and answer session at the end.
Right.
Yeah, quick question: are you going to make these slides available on a website inquiry? They're really great. I'd love to be able to refer to them later.
Sure.
Yeah, those are, all the slides will be available on the stewardship website, so it's anthonycandiego.com. And their video will also be available for the presentation.
Okay, anything else?
I have a question.
Sure.
So for cities designing new streets or existing streets, if there's making any improvements on their streets, are they going to have to adhere as well to all of these new stormwater regulations? And how are they going to fit that in if they have a very narrow roadway or planting area?
That's a very good question. Yes, they will have to integrate these. There are some limited exemptions for if you're just installing a sidewalk, I believe, then it can be exempt. But if you're doing a new sidewalk and new curb and a widening, then you need to comply with these. There is also an exemption for streets that are designed with Green Street guidance. So if you're, the county has published a Green Street standards manual as part of the BMP design manual. And if the street is designed in compliance with that, then it can be exempt from the the numeric BMP sizing criteria, but you still need to integrate, you know, LID and BMPs within the Green Street for that to qualify as well.
Where do you put the street trees when you go over and take space?
That's a very good question as well. And it's kind of a site-specific issue. It is an issue. Like the depth of the soil layer within the biofiltration basins can be varied, assuming you have sufficient depth available in your storm drain system to allow for deeper root volumes. But the biofiltration soil media as well is not something that's particularly conducive for plant growth. It's a high infiltration soil, and there's a specification for that soil in the BMP design manual. So that needs to be taken into account as well in selecting tree and plant material.
How long is it taking, play around it, play the ground media that is basis, gets a buildup of pollutants and have to redo it?
The general maintenance guidelines say that in five to 10 years, the soil media needs to be maintained. And that's basically driven by observation of clogging and standing water. So if it stops perking, then you know the soil media has become clogged and needs to be renewed. That is a concern going long term. Okay, well, I'll be available at the end of the presentation for questions as well.
Thank you so much, Ken. And as Ken said, we will have a larger question and answer period at the end. At this time, I'd like to invite Chris. Come on up, Chris. Chris is, as I mentioned before, Chris is with Hunter, and Chris is going to talk to us today about the new MWello ordinance. I'm going to keep that up there.
So I'm just hanging on my claws here.
Everybody hear me okay? No. Nope. Did you turn it off? Hello? Hello? Needs to go way up. How about now? Is this okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Groovy. So great job, Ken. Thank you. I did think that there was a request from ASLA to do the presentations in English. Because I'm in the back, I was like, I needed an interpreter. And what I'm starting to think is I didn't put enough pictures in my presentation. If you know me and if I've ever bored you with a presentation before, at least I gave you something to look at. Okay, this is the only photo I have in this entire presentation, okay? This stuff's that boring that you're not allowed to put photos in it, okay? So at least Ken mixed it up a little bit. Thank you for doing that. Because I needed visuals. So anyway, there's some disclaimers here. First of all, I did not write this. That's my first disclaimer, okay? We were all part of making the industry a better place. And I think the changes that we're starting to see with the Model Water Efficient Landscape Ordinance, it's evolved over time. And I think it's all changes for the better. You know, we have a shortage in our water supply here in California. We're in the fourth year of major drought. You could claim, you know, one year over the next, it just keeps getting worse. We had some executive orders that really drove home some of these changes. But by and large, the Department of Water Resources is the governing agency that's really responsible for looking out for our water supply, you know, throughout the state of California. And they have a very difficult job to do, to balance the politics of water with the practicality of the delivery of water and looking at the long-range future, you know, 25, 30 years ahead. And you know, of course, our local agencies are doing that as well. So most of the information that you're going to hear today was taken from the Department of Water Resources website. Down at the bottom here, you'll see that there is a link that you could click on. I believe it's a hot link. When you open up the PDF that'll be available to you after the presentation. So you can click on that, and then all of the different supporting documents are going to be right here on, you know, under those different subtitles. So has anybody taken a look at this so far? Anybody dabbled in it? Okay, some of you. So for those of you that haven't, I don't want to depress anybody with some of the changes, but also for some of you that, yeah, I mean, obviously we're looking to try and stay current with what's going on, so I'm just the messenger, okay? So where we started was the Model Water Efficient Landscape Ordinance, AB 1881, was a revision of AB 325. You remember all the last major drought that we had with the 90s, and then we had the March Miracle, and everybody went from drip back to spray heads, right? So you guys that have been in California and San Diego long enough, remember that this has been a cycle of how we've done things, right? Well, AB 1881, and I believe it was like 2007, 2008 when they started, it kind of started growing legs, and they started getting some independent technical panels and people involved with this and industry, and came together and wrote a document that took place in 2010. Okay, so what we're looking at now is the revisions to AB 1881. So some of this stuff that you're going to see on these slides is going to be in gray. And most of that's just stuff that has already been in place, okay? So don't think that everything here is changed. I think there's about 18 unique changes from the original 2010 to what was launched on December 1st of 2015, which is now the new changes to the Model Water Efficient Landscape Ordinance, okay? So anything in blue is going to be the new changes, and anything in gray is going to be existing, but it kind of supports the concepts that we're talking about here. Big thing is new projects requiring a landscape permit greater than or equal to 500 square feet are going to be required to comply with the MWLO. We're going to call it MWLO, okay, because that's the short for Model Water Efficient Landscape Ordinance. It also applies to rehabilitated projects that are you know, requiring a building permit, not just if you, hey, I want to do my yard, but you didn't trigger a building permit, but if it's a commercial or you know, landscape area that is 2,500 square feet or more that requires a permit from some other purpose, either a landscape permit or a some sort of a building permit where landscape is a part of it. Okay, now with 500 square feet to 2,500 square feet in the residential category, that kind of falls to the prescriptive compliance, and there's more of a more or less a checklist that you can do that home builders might now on new homes will turn over a turnover package to the homeowner, and they'll sign at that point saying that we're going to comply to the MWELO with the backyard or future modifications to our landscape. And that's a prescriptive compliance checklist option. So unfortunately, you don't get to charge fees to the small little cookie cutter homes that, you know, in my neighborhood. But as people move in, you know, they're going to need to be cognizant of the ordinance, and that's how we're hitting the smaller homes. So the applicable projects do not apply to state or federal historical sites. They also don't apply to ecological restorations where you don't need permanent irrigation. So sometimes there's native or vegetation projects. It's a temporary grow-in, get the natives going, and then turn it off. And then also mined land projects not requiring permanent irrigation. Sometimes there's wetting for dust control and things like that. And then, of course, plant collections, our arboretums, our botanical gardens, and places that the public can go and view native plant collections. Okay, this is the other big word. Maximum applied water allowance, also referred to as the MAWA calculation. Now, those of you that have been designing with the previous version, AB 1881, know that the MAWA is the total water use that you're allowed to use for your site per year, right? And we take the reference ET for your location, and we determine that by the square footage. And then that will give you a number that you can use for your total water use for your site. And then there's some subsets of that. The ET adjustment factor, ETAF, also known as, was formerly 0.7 or 70% of ET. So if cool season turf or your 100% adjustment factor was 100%, we're allowed to design to 70% of that. Okay. With the changes, residential is now 0.55 ET adjustment factor. So we can design to 55% of ET for residential. Commercial goes down to 0.45, okay? So now what we're doing is we're talking about, you know, how we're going to design more water efficient landscapes than we've done in the past. And I think this is going to start to shape some of the direction that might limit some of our options in terms of plants. But it'll also, again, it's going to help us reduce our water consumption. DSA projects, Division of the State Architect is what that stands for, and that's basically K-12 schools. That has an ETAF of 0.65. Okay, so schools are going to get a little bit more water. We want our kids to have a little bit more greenery to run around on, I guess. And then existing minor improvements that you might have, it's going to fall back to that 0.8 adjustment factor, 80% of ET. Now, special landscaped areas. What is a special landscaped area? Okay. An SLA is classified as like an edible garden, a place that is used for recreation. Okay, could be considered a special landscaped area. Recycled water areas, projects using recycled water. And one other thing I'm forgetting. Let's see. What's that? Active use sports facilities. There's one more thing on there. Yeah, this is the one where our slides had the little cheat sheet on here. A water feature, yes, that's correct, So SLA means an area of landscape dedicated solely to edible plants, recreational areas, areas irrigated with recycled water, or water features using recycled water, okay? So let's just tackle recycled water right off the bat. It's a great resource if we can get an alternate water supply like recycled water. The purple pipe come into our project, it's great. It has to be designed in accordance with state laws. As we all know, there's some requirements of recycled water that we don't want it to come in contact with the public. You get 1.0 ETAF if you recycled water. Okay, so there's some breathing room there if you're using recycled water. Now, there's some potential changes to that, some modifications, which we'll get to in a little bit as it relates to the independent technical panel. I want to talk to you a little bit about that, because now that we're already making these updates and we're kind of briefing you guys on the updates, there's other folks that are already trying to update this again. So we're going to continue to see updates of this, and things might change a little bit more. But water features should be classified as high water use, so factor of one. Temporarily irrigated areas shall be calculated as low water use. So even though we're going to temporarily irrigate them, they're considered low water use hydrozones, so you factor that in. And then the ETAF for existing special landscaped areas shall not exceed 1.0. That's just kind of a recap. Now, a local compliance that we're looking at is for synthetic turf areas. The city of San Diego, I believe, is using a low water use. Is that correct from the city? It's using low water use, and I know the county is considering it a moderate use. Okay. So your entire area irrigated or non-irrigated by synthetic turf, there's an implication that you're going to use water to cool it, clean it, whatever you need to do. So there is a water factor for that as well. Okay. Now let's move on to soil management report. We got to talk about our soils, and we got to know exactly what we've got. We got to try and encourage good water holding conditions in our soil. We want to get healthy, active, living soils if we can. That's really important. So a soil analysis is really critical because we need to know where we start. What does our site have before we break ground? So we need to get a soil report. And these are the things that are required now for your soil management report. Always a good idea to get a soil report. You don't know where you're going unless you know where you start, right? Now it's a requirement. We got to do it. Client says, we don't need a report. Well, we do. So we're going to take a sample rate for production homes, for example, in a new development. 1 in 7 lots is going to need to require a soil sample for residential development plots. And then now we go to the landscape design plan. So we've got our soil management report. We know what our soil is. Now we get to design the landscape. Here's the fun part. We got to achieve water efficiency, and there's some different changes in that. But the things that stay the same is we want to preserve our native species. Changes are we're really shifting toward using locally native plants. Locally native, not just native because it's native to somewhere, but locally native. As we all know, we've had that conversation before. And then, of course, climate-appropriate plants, local climate suitability. And that's, we were just at the Cuyamaca College conference. There was phenomenal speakers on locally native plants and just some beautiful examples. And then there's some not-so-beautiful examples that, you see. But I think it's encouraging to know that we can use natives and still have a beautiful, attractive landscape. So it can be done. Trees based on local ordinances, this is a big thing. We want to know we get the right tree, the right size, right application. So we want to know what the tree size is at maturity, not when it's really cute in a little 15-gallon container. And we don't want to tear up our streets and sidewalks and stuff. So know what it is to the appropriate planting area. Pretty basic for most of you, but we use local plant lists from landscape programs, and there's a lot of those. San Diego County Water Authority has various lists that you can use. I know ASLA, I think, has some local plants that are recommended. And then the big thing is your fuel modification. So we need to default to the fire code, okay? If you're in Rancho Santa Fe, they don't want you putting a palm tree right next to the building. There's certain things that, different types of trees, we want to keep them, in the right vicinity in relationship to structures and fuel modification plans. And that might be, slopes and things like that. So check your local guidelines for that. As far as turf goes, now turf's kind of a broad description of grasses and things like that, but turf, grass, were high water use landscaped areas or high water use landscape materials, such as turf grass, prohibited on slope areas greater than 25%. That's been there. High water use plants, AKA turf, according to Governor Brown, is prohibited in street medians. That was the first thing they came out and said, and I was like, hey, look, we gotta get rid of high water use areas that are non-functional. Why would we waste all the water where we can't benefit from it? So that's a big thing. Turf shall not exceed 25% of the total landscape area on residential projects. That's new. Prohibited on non-residential unless it's considered a special landscaped area, a recreation area, you know, schools, things like that. It's prohibited in parkways less than 10 feet wide, or 10 feet or less, I should say, in parkways, unless it's in a parkway where the parking strip is used to enter or exit a vehicle. And I think builders commented on this because a lot of times they want the green grass strip so you can get in and out of your car without stumbling or slipping. It became a safety factor, so that is an exception. Soil preparation, you know, mulch and amendments. We're getting a little bit more prescriptive now in this. They're actually requiring you to till and make sure you have transformed your planting surface into a friable condition, except for when it's on a slope. If it's on a slope, we just need to dig the area where we're going to put the plant in the ground, and that's all we need to disturb, okay? So there's kind of some contention upon, like, you know, how much area should be tilled or broken up, but that's kind of the way the ordinance is reading it now. So soil amendments shall be incorporated into the soil report. We need to know what we're putting in, pretty much based on what the report says. We're gonna need to know that we have to put amendments in if the report recommended it. And they're actually even recommending a rate at, you know, 4 cubic feet per 1,000 square feet must be incorporated at a 6-inch depth. Okay, so soils with 6% organic matter, things like that are already complying, you don't need to do anything, obviously, but it needs to be within the top 6 inches. So this is another one that gets a little sticky. Mulch is required, and 3 inches of it. It used to be 2 inches, now they're requiring 3 inches, but 5% of the area may be left open for unmulched areas for wildlife, insect habitat, and slopes are exempt. You know, fire prevention guidelines, again, where mulch can blow around and become a fire hazard, those are exempt. And then turf areas, creeping ground cover, and seeded areas. And there's kind of a note on this that I think, in general, a lot of the native plant folks wanted to make a note of, is that you're probably well served to not over mulch your native plant areas, particularly where the crown of the plant is, maybe keeping some of the mulch back in that area there. But again, the purpose of this, and it goes kind of back to what Ken was doing, is we're trying to keep the water on site. We're trying to retain the moisture in the soil. And, you know, mulch isn't a bad thing to keep weeds down, too. It's good to, you know, keep and protect living soils. But it really keeps the hydration and the moisture into the soil. So in general, it's a good thing, but use caution around some of your natives. That's a more of a perspective, not the ordinance. And again, organic mulch, they're preferring that you use organic mulch from, you know, recycled material rather than, you know, materials that are, you know, virgin forest products, things like that. And again, fuel modification guidelines, what type of mulch you use is going to be critical to your local guidelines. We're doing okay so far? It's like drinking from a fire hydrant, isn't it? Two of these back to back is like sweet. I was thinking, I'm driving over here, I'm like, okay, 40 minutes, I'm gonna need to hit one of those 6 coffee crafts, and I'd probably take one myself. If I don't at least drink a cup of coffee before I come up here, like, people are gonna be asleep. And so there's plenty of coffee in the back, but I don't know what good it's gonna do you in 20 minutes. So anyhow, a lot of information, very condensed. You're getting it thick today. So water features, okay, water features can be used, but they need to be recirculating systems. That's really, you know, the standard. I don't know. I don't think I've ever really seen, well, maybe I've seen one, but I don't think I've seen many water features that just kind of dump water that don't recirculate. But a lot of people turn their water features off because they thought that they couldn't have them based on the last ordinance. And of course, public perception with evaporation, you know, I guess that's the prerogative. But it was recirculating systems. Recycled water should also be used whenever available. And the surface area of water features, basically a pool or your overall water feature, you take the overall surface area of that, and that is totalized in your estimated total water use calculation as a high water use hydrozone. We covered that before, but we get a lot of questions about that. Hey, gosh, I haven't done a water feature in a while. What was that again? Well, high water use based on the square footage. Recommend pool covers and spa covers. Now you get to the irrigation design plan. This is the part that we like, you know, sprinkler geeks kind of think is the fun part, but not all of you do, apparently. Based on calls that we get, oh God, can you just help me get through this? Yeah, that's not gonna do it. We're talking about permanent irrigation systems. So the irrigation design plan, it's a permanent system, not a temporary system. Projects are gonna require submeters, okay? Irrigation submeters. So what we do is we have a meter that supplies the whole facility, and our client wants to do some new landscaping, and it triggers the ordinance, right? We know that we have a meter for the water going in the building, but how much water would we be using outside of the building? They say, well, we don't have a dedicated irrigation meter, so just pull it off, tee it off of here and use that. Okay, well, we need to be able to monitor and measure how much water is being consumed exterior for irrigation. That's what we use a submeter for. So you have the city's meter or the local utility meter, and then you tee off of that, and now you have a submeter prior to your irrigation system. And that's kind of the definition of that in a nutshell. For non-residential systems, we're thresholding it at 1,000 square feet or greater. Residential is going to be 5,000 square feet or greater. So a little larger residential lot, at least to today's standards, is going to require an irrigation submeter. Okay. Greater than or equal to 5,000 square feet. Now, submeters, this is something that was kind of brought up as it's in the ordinance, but it's kind of fuzzy. Can I use a flow sensor as a submeter? Well, they're really kind of two different things by definition, but it does say in the ordinance that you can use a flow sensor, and it may function as a water meter via section V490. We get that a lot. Hey, I got it. What's a flow sensor? What's a submeter? Can I use it as the same? There are devices that will act as both out there on the market, so you can actually have a submeter and it can send information to your irrigation controller. Those are great solutions. And then, there is some kind of gray area, even though it's in blue. So so controllers usually using ET or soil moisture sensors data are required. So either an ET-based controller or something with a sensor that goes in the soil that's going to give us a reading to tell us, hey, I'm wet, shut off, we don't need to water anymore. Something that's going to adjust the schedule. And then, of course, controllers equipped with non-volatile memory. That's something I wish I had, because now I feel like as we get, as we think back to what was it on the last ordinance? Well, geez, I can't even remember. The controllers today tend to hold their programs in the event of a power outage. And what we used to have is a controller that looked like the alarm clock when the power went out and it was flashing 12 o'clock and it went to a default program, so it woke you up at 6 a.m. instead of 8:30, which I don't wake up at 8:30, but people do, and sometimes it's annoying when your alarm clock wakes you up at 6 o'clock because it defaulted, but nowadays the sprinkler controllers are going to hold that program for you, which is really critical because you've spent a lot of time investing in getting that cycle and soak program in your controller and the program days of the week so you don't get fined for watering on non-water days. The controller's going to hold all that memory in the event of a power outage if it's got what's considered non-volatile memory. So manufacturers have taken note of that. The other thing we want to do is if we do have a rain occurrence, we want to avoid the embarrassment of watering in the rain, so rain sensors have become mandatory. You may have a weather-based ET controller that's pulling information from off-site, you'll still need to have a rain sensor on-site to prevent the water from coming on your site. Because, you know, sometimes it rains other places where maybe it's not on our site, but then on our site it's raining, and, you know, it's really embarrassing to go out there with the rain on, with the sprinklers on in the rain. You get a lot of phone calls, too, on this side of the business. Freeze sensing is an option as well. And then, of course, wind. You know, you don't want to irrigate in the wind most of the time. That's just bad for uniformity. So, now, pressure regulation. Okay, so we get this question a lot. Do I have to use a pressure regulator? Where can I put the pressure regulator in the system? Does it have to be in the head? Well, as a manufacturer, I'll say yes, because that's a great place to put it. And, you know, it's nice because if you do go and change out a system, it's nice to have a pressure regulator at the head, because that's exactly where the nozzle is going to perform, is within maybe 4 or 6 inches of that pressure regulator. So you know that every emission device has the same amount of pressure throughout the system. But it's not required that you do that. It's required that you have that pressure at each device. So when you look at a manufacturer's catalog, there's several good manufacturers. There's a few other manufacturers in the room. In our catalogs, they're going to have a PSI number next to the product. And it's going to recommend, for in general, like a spray head, have 30 PSI. So spray nozzles, 30 PSI. We're not using as many of those today. Rotating nozzles, 40, 45 PSI. Rotors, 50 and 45 and up. So what we're looking for is that we get to that pressure. So if you do your calculations and you know that you got exactly 30 at that head, you might not need a pressure regulator. But if you don't have 50 or 60 PSI where you need a rotor, you're probably gonna have to put in a pump. And it's now required that you pressurize to get to the manufacturer's recommended operating pressure, okay? Just because it says it on our plan and it says, you know, X type of sprinkler throws X feet at 30 PSI, we need to make sure that when we were to go out to the site that it's going to have 30 PSI at that sprinkler. Because we're designing it to that, and if we increase the pressure on that, it's going to have more water go through the sprinkler, and our actual usage on site, our consumption, would be different than what our plans read. So they're really focused on making sure we have the right pressure at each emission device. Is that clear? Is mud? Yeah, I probably butchered that. But manual shutoff valve should be installed as close as possible to the point of connection. That's great. So if you do have a break, people can quickly shut off the system and isolate it. So sometimes it's nice just because then you can still irrigate parts of your landscape if you do multiples in there and not have the entire site off if you have a mainline break. Backflow devices, standard to local codes, that's just standard. Flow sensor requirements. This is that other device that we talked about that's at the point of connection, after the meter, we're going to have a device that's going to read and monitor flow and send information back to the controller. Now, those used to be optional. There's a lot of them that have gone in, you know, over the years and never really got connected. Now we're looking to make sure that these sensors are not only installed, but are actually reading at the controller. And all non-residential sites are required to have a flow sensor now. Some public agencies have required that for years, but now that's new to MWLO. And residential landscapes over 5,000 square feet need to have a flow sensor. Manufacturers didn't write this, I swear, because we probably would have added more in there about that stuff if we did. The master valve requirement. Now, if you have a flow sensor, you need to be able to do something about that broken sprinkler that was registered on the flow sensor, because the flow sensor is going to send data back to the controller, and the controller is going to say, hey, wait, that's way higher than I saw last time, or when I learned what my flow should be, that's out of spec, so what do I do now? I want to shut the system off. So it can skip that zone, but what happens if there's still water flowing out, and it's still reading after it thinks it shut off that sprinkler zone and try to skip to go to the next one? So you need to have a master valve that can close down and shut off your main line back at the point of connection to respond to the flow sensors, the flow sensors data that the controller says, let's turn off the system. You have to have a master valve in order to shut off the main line. Okay? Perfect. Normally, closed master valves are recommended according to the ordinance. And also, we got to design our irrigation to prevent runoff. That's pretty standard, obviously. Hydrozones. Hydrozones are like plant material. We all know that we don't want to design, you know, sprinklers and mixed sprinkler types, you know, drip and spray heads on the same line. That, of course, is not something you would have done anyway, but we need to design our irrigation based on the hydrozone with matched precipitation rates. That means that everything over the given area is going to be watered evenly. And low volume irrigation devices are required in mulched areas, low volume. So that could be drip or some sort of other low volume irrigation device. Swing joints are required adjacent to hardscape and high traffic turf areas. A swing joint is something that will flex the sprinkler over so it doesn't break off at the base. It'll kind of flex over and prevent it from leaking and breaking. Check valves are required at all emission devices where runoff may occur. So check valves are basically, it's a low head drainage prevention device so that gravity doesn't drain all the water out of your system. And those are required at all emission devices where runoff may occur. It used to be an option, now it's standard. Areas less than 10 feet or less in width shall be irrigated with subsurface irrigation or other areas that do not allow overspray or runoff. Other means, I should say. So this could be, you know, your subsurface drip tubing or some sort of a low volume device that isn't going to backspray onto the hardscape and have water leaving the site. Overhead irrigation shall not be permitted within the first 24 inches. This is that 2-foot setback from the curb on non-permeable surfaces. So if we work with the good folks over at Fusco and Ken and say, hey, Ken, I need this thing to drain back into the landscape. Can I get all my sidewalks and any of my hardscape areas, either use a non-permeable source like, you know, like a Bellegarde paver or something like that so the water's going to drain in, or I need to get my sidewalks to drain back into the landscape, or I need to move my heads 24 inches in away from the hardscape so I don't get any back spray that would otherwise run off and leave the site. Again, it goes back to the storm water quality thing. Slopes greater than 25% shall not be irrigated with an irrigation system that's over 0.75 inches an hour. And 0.75 inches an hour is a very, very low application rate as sprinklers are concerned. But if you think about rainfall, 3/4 of an inch is quite a lot of rain in 1 hour. So think about that. We want to water the slopes at the rate that the soil could take it. And trees and shrubs need to be irrigated on their own dedicated valve. This is what we're finding now with the drought. Everybody's shutting off the irrigation, but we don't have a way just to keep the trees alive. So we need to be able to irrigate the trees on their own dedicated valves. Okay, so emission performance for devices, this is something that the state's taking very seriously. They're not just saying, hey, manufacturer, what's your best guess at what your device's efficiencies are? And what, you know, what are, do you guys have any standards that we can use from you? No, they're saying we need an outside third party. And so the ASABE ICC standards is what they're using. American Society of Agriculture and Biological Engineer, International Code Council. And the minimum requirement for an irrigation device overhead has a DULQ, which is a distribution uniformity, lower quarter. That's how efficiently does the device irrigate. Where's the dry spot, essentially? The dry spots in the landscape typically are your lower quarter of efficiency, uniformity, and that must be a minimum of 0.65 distribution uniformity lower quarter, and that's typically determined based on an irrigation catchment audit. Irrigation efficiencies, this is the fun part for manufacturers, okay? This is where we get into our calculation of how efficient is that device that we're going to be putting on our plan. And overhead devices must be greater than or equal to 0.75 or 75% efficient. Subsurface drip irrigation, minimum of 0.81, greater than or equal to 0.81. In some local jurisdictions, I think the county, Dave could probably talk to this in the panel discussion in a moment. It's a different approach, which is a little bit more specific, and its drip irrigation is going to have a 0.9. Bubblers, 0.85. Rotating nozzles, 0.75. Rotors, 0.7. And conventional spray is 0.6. And the overall, so if you take your square footage of these irrigated areas by these devices, your total average, overall average, needs to be 0.75, okay? That last slide didn't get updated, so we're gonna fast forward through that, okay? So 0.75 is the average for all areas, okay? So sorry about that, that was a little sleight of hand there. We didn't get that slide modified like we had thought we did. So 0.75 is the overall average for slopes and flat space. Am I correct on that? Okay, good. So audits shall be conducted by a local landscape agency landscape auditor or a third-party certified landscape irrigation auditor. Okay. Unfortunately, it can't be conducted by those of us that designed it or those of us that installed it. So Benchmark, find a friendly irrigation auditor that you can go have sign off your work, because you're gonna, you know, for the landscape contractor, we're going to need to have a third party go out and just verify that everything got put in correctly, that our nozzles are pointed in the right direction, all the good stuff you're normally gonna do, but they're going to take and inspect the site even further. And now, catch can audits, things like that, that's yet to be determined by local agency as to how detailed that's going to be. But what we do know is from the state's perspective is that if you did have that residential subdivision and you're going to go audit, you need to audit 1 in 7 lots or 15% of the total developed site for a residential project. Okay, so we're almost there. Hang in there, a couple more slides. And audits shall be submitted with the certificate of completion and may be included, or may include but not limited to, the site inspection, system tune-up, system test with distribution uniformity, that would be a catch can test, reporting overspray and runoff, and the preparation of an irrigation schedule. And the irrigation schedule is really critical. I think that's where the rubber meets the road on a lot of this stuff. Smart controllers do a good job, but the state is requiring us to have an irrigation schedule as part of that. This is where the teeth kind of come into this. You know, it's like, it's good to have a good design, but now they're requiring us to go out and audit the system. And as we're starting to see in a lot of agencies, that is becoming a reality. So they're going to check and make sure that this is actually happening. And then kind of lastly, we get into alternative water supplies. You know, we talked about recycled water as being a great option. If you can use it, you get a 1.0. So that's a good thing as your starting point. But with stormwater and rainwater retention, the big thing is we're following stormwater best management practices. So thank you for briefing us on that, Ken. And all projects, and we're going to refer to local agency requirements because it's going to be different in the city of San Diego, possibly Carlsbad, the different jurisdictions that you go to. So if you do a lot of work in a lot of areas, you're going to have to look at different requirements there. And then all planted areas required to have friable soils to maximize water retention and water infiltration. That's really big, because if we get the soil to intake water better, we're going to have less runoff, and the water that we're using is going to be applied to the root zone where we want it, and not in dry season runoff where we don't want it. Rainwater, that's the other thing. Things have changed. Rainwater, we're again, the first inch, or follow what Ken said, for the first 24-hour event, the 85th percentile of a 24-hour event. These are all things that are going to be kind of required by the state, and that's something that county has been very progressive with, and we've been getting on top of this, getting ahead of this, I think, in San Diego. So the rest of those guys got to catch up. But recommended that projects incorporate elements to improve, you know, stormwater and dry season runoff capture, so that we do not have pollutants getting into our storm water in our watershed. alternative gray water supply systems, they've really relaxed the plumbing codes to some degree, or actually focused on the plumbing codes now to be able to accept gray water irrigation systems where feasible. So for example, a good use of gray water in a residential scenario might be, you know, your laundry. Gray water is considered water that's come in contact, direct contact with the skin, and then is going to be used for something such as irrigation. We can't drink that water, but we can get that water directly from the source and take it directly out to our irrigation system. We can't store it, but we can use it to irrigate. And it must conform to the California Plumbing Code, so check your local agencies on that. The other thing is now, the water needs to be applied 2 inches below finished grade. There's some changes now to where you can actually take the, from what I understand from the state's perspective, is that you can take the irrigation directly out to the landscape and cover it up with the mulch, and now that is acceptable for the gray water system. But we don't want anybody to drink the gray water thinking that it's okay to drink out of the sprinklers. So anyway, with that being said, I think that's about the last of it, unless anybody thinks I missed anything. Okay, great. So that's it. Thank you very much. So with that, we could...
Thanks so much, Chris.
Welcome panelists.
This is not on. Guys, we're limited on our microphones right now, and I'm going to find a solution to that. But right now, I'm going to pass this along. If you could introduce yourself.
I'm Dave Kaler with the County of San Diego, landscape architect with the Planning and Department of Development Services.
I'm Stephanie Gaines with the County of San Diego's Watershed Protection Program.
I'm Mary Radley at the City of Chula Vista Development Services Department.
I'm Gary Hoyt, landscape architect. I represent the cities of Poway, La Mesa, and Menifee.
Harry Lee, City of San Diego, landscape.
So with that, I'd like to open it up to questions.
There's two different parts to that. There's firstly somebody having inspected during installation, checking that, you know, the trenches are correctly built and the backflow is right and all that sort of thing, and pressure testing. That in Chula Vista we have a landscape inspector who does that. But then there'll also be a requirement in your on your drawings or in your specs saying that you'll do this landscape audit with an independent person. And that needs to be done before you turn over that landscape at the very end of the process. So that's going to be the contractor who has to get hold of one of these auditors to do this function, as far as I understand it.
Okay.
Hopefully that answers your question.
Joe, if the county, you as the designer, would be required to ensure during construction that the irrigation went in as you designed it.
Right.
And that would be in that certificate of completion when it's submitted.
Testing.
But then we're also asking for an audit report by a third person that tests the irrigation system, make sure the uniformity is there, no leaks, the controller is set up, based on your irrigation system and schedule that you put together. So that's a third party.
And that would happen prior to when you signed off with the next year.
Correct.
Yeah.
So who's qualified to be that person?
The state has basically said anybody that has followed the Irrigation Association's protocol for auditing, it's just can't be the designer of the plan or the installer of the plan of the landscape.
I think that's something that's still getting sorted out with this process. My clients have indicated they're somewhat concerned with just a single source as irrigation auditors. In other words, CLIA is kind of the gold standard, but I think there's need for some flexibility in that requirement. So we're kind of looking at, you know, other options, other viable options for auditing reports. Quell is a program that's out there that my clients are looking at is perhaps allowing to do audits and or Quell certified. So there's still some discussion sorting out of that requirement. I wish I had a definite answer for you, but certainly certification is a good start. I mean, if you have someone that's
sounds like we need to take on an assignment.
Well, I think the industry needs to look at that, definitely.
Yeah.
As I'm sure you're all very busy, as we get these requirements usually occur at the end of projects, and there's a lot of pressure to get things signed off. And it's my experience is developers, applicants, in many cases, have had difficulty finding high-certified auditors to do that if they're looking just for those qualifications. So I think we need some flexibility there. If you folks have some ideas, again, Quell is a good option. But
in the city of San Diego, we have a trigger in our inspection process that prevents occupancy until we get that audit report turned in.
Check.
I wanted to ask my question.
Oh, yeah, after.
So I had a question actually for Stephanie. We're going back to the stormwater, and Ken showed us his lovely rash map. I love that. Could you talk a little bit about the critical sediment yields? Because that seems counterintuitive to us as designers and, you know, trying to stabilize erosions, and they're like, oh yes, we want this area to erode. So, you know, what kind of properties did you guys find in the mapping process, and how much do you think that will implement, like, developable science?
That's an amazing question, and that's why I brought my engineer. I'd like to introduce Stuart Kuhn and ask if he could address that question. But I also think there's another part to that question that you want me to address, and I'm happy to do that when he's done talking about critical core sediment yield.
Okay, where do I start? So the critical core sediment yield comes back to Lane's diagram, which is in a stream for it to be stable and not have sediment deposit and cover up all the plants or erode and pull all the plants away. You need to have a consistent supply of water, a balanced supply of water, and a balanced supply of sediment that kind of keeps the stream where it's at. So those areas that produce critical sediment, which is like kind of a sandy material, need to be protected. So the county has worked with our slope protection guidelines to pretty much consolidate into those areas so that their requirements you're already having to meet so that you can meet that critical core sediment yield. Now there's additional requirements that you have to be able to convey. If you have a steep slope draining through your project, you need to design your project so that that sediment in that water can convey through your project, and it's not going through a filtration device or a swale or a landscaped area where the sediment's going to fall out and be captured on your site. Did I get everything there?
Yeah, and just the last piece, maybe where, as you were studying those, what types of sites did you typically find that were undeveloped? Are those ones that would be foreseeably development material, or would they be more habitat areas?
It's the MSCP is where we were able to identify as most you're able to comply with the MSCP requirements on your project and not infringe on those areas, then you would be also compliant with the preservation of the critical core sediment yield area.
Is there a question?
I wanted to follow up on the previous question about the auditing, because there is an independent technical, I'm Joella Jacoby, and I'm in the Water Conservation Program with the City of San Diego. And so anyway, there's an independent technical panel that's suggesting new modifications beyond what you just saw for MWLO, and among the things is a broadening of who will be certified. The recommendations that are going to go forward from the city and county, I believe, is that it would be any WaterSense certified professional, which would include the CLIA, the QL, QUEL, and the watershed-wise landscape professional. So it is the larger group of people that would be qualified with that. This is just the future, but they're thinking about it. So I just kind of wanted to give you an update on that. There are other things that are being brought up by the independent technical panel that also affect the MWLO. And John Rzynski from ASLA was on the conference call, so he's preparing comments for that also.
Now, that's true. What you say and what Chris alluded to earlier is that while all this is going on and we've collectively almost got our ordinances put together, the state is coming up with new regulations that are going to basically over the next 20 years try to cut back on the amount of water that we're using for outdoor irrigation by 50% of what we're using today. And they've got all these convoluted ways of doing that that will be spread out over this 20-year period. The landscape ordinance, the MWLO, is tentatively set to go on a triannual basis, similar to Cal Green ordinances and updates. So this is all going to be changing constantly.
Okay, so I'm Marianne Marum, landscape architect in private practice. Could I hear from any or all of you about renovation projects? Because everything that was described is very clear to most of us for permitted projects, but renovation, water saving projects that do not require a permit, how does any of this get monitored, or what am I supposed to do to in these conditions, in these circumstances, because I have a lot of them.
At the county, we have a modified landscape plan. We don't have a rehabilitated, that's not really a definition that we have in our ordinance, but we have a modified landscape plan process where if you've already had a permit issued on that property, we've already got a landscape plan that is approved, and you're coming back at some later date and you want to modify something, we've got a window of 10%. If it changes 10% or more, we'll bring it in as a modification. If the plan was approved prior to this ordinance and water budgets were set up under that previous ordinance, you would now be apply the new ordinance to that. So new calculations would be required for that modification. If you don't have a permit on the property, we really just don't know about you. So we wrestle with that a lot and have to deal with the state's requirements, at least at the county level. And if there's no permit on that property, like I said, we don't know you.
Okay. So there's some other things.
Guys, could you speak into the microphone just so it's recorded on our video so that if you want to
can
see
you
it
hear
later,
me?
Everyone can hear it?
Thanks. With the stormwater aspect, we have our water quality improvement plans. Our water quality improvement plans set forth certain specific goals that we have to hit, numeric goals, and we've described strategies to meet those goals. And strategies basically translate to projects. One of the projects that we're looking at is landscape retrofits. And one of the things that we've worked with recently is a local grant project. Joey's a partner on that project, I am. And I don't see anybody else here from our team. But it's a sustainable landscapes project. It is a voluntary project. It's an incentive-based grant project, but it fundamentally takes care of what you're talking about. It's those turf replacement, basically, or we like to call it a landscape upgrade because we're doing something a little better. But we're looking at the tenets of, you know, stormwater capture for use, efficient irrigation, using all of the practices that we saw today in implementing the MWELO and water efficient practices, and especially the plant palette, looking at moderate, low, and very low water use plants. We look at natives, we look at edibles, we look at trees for the very reason that you talked about trees, you know, the stormwater capture aspect and the tree wells and the capacity that they have. So from a voluntary standpoint, we have things like that, and we will be tracking those metrics, if you will, those conversions, to report annually to the regional board as part of our compliance metric. And I just want to be clear, the project itself is voluntary, but the compliance metric on our end is required. We've got to be able to demonstrate that we can meet water quality objectives at some point in the future. Does that help describe one other aspect of what we're doing?
Yes, I may have another question for you, that on finding people, property owners getting cited, if they make changes and runoff is happening, and they're actually getting cited. So I may come back and ask you a specific question about that.
Okay.
I'd just like to reflect what David said, that at the various cities and municipalities, we're really only able to check the projects that come into us for review. And we're aware that there's an awful lot of landscape activity goes on, which we don't see. And I suppose for that, we're looking to the profession to start becoming responsible and applying some of the same principles as a matter of course. But if it doesn't go through an agency, it won't be checked.
Yes, Marion, the same with the cities that I represent. Projects are triggered by permits. So that's how we track and that's how we review and inspect. So, yeah.
We've been seeing a lot of renovation projects coming in, partly for overgrown landscape from the 1980s and 1990s, and where water conservation wasn't as much of a consideration. Where the retrofit is purely dealing with plant material, we've been able to do that with our substantial conformance review process to record that. If they're doing retrofits to hardscape and irrigation systems, we'll possibly have a building permit tied to that, and then the retrofit areas, we will be looking for the efficiencies. But to this point, if it's an existing irrigation system to remain, we haven't gone into that. So that's going to be a challenge, especially if it's an older system.
And when you say you're seeing it, is that seeing it on a voluntary basis?
For renovation, yes. And we encourage people to come to us because there's other layers that go with the landscaping. As you know, there may be a discretionary entitlement that has specific species for various reasons, and we have to scrutinize whether the replacement is appropriate or not beyond the water conservation component.
Well, so can I?
Thank you, guys, because I've been really struggling with what do I do. But the question I guess I have for you is, how will you make it clear to our industry? A lot of us are here today and maybe getting clarification on this nicely today, but how do we know whether, you know, we're supposed to voluntarily submit or just say la 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 and hope that we don't have to? How is this industry gonna deal with all these renovations that are happening?
I know you're struggling with this, but cities are struggling too, and part of it is I think the nature of development right now, there's a lot of activity. It's hard to keep up with the new projects, let alone things that are flying under the radar, if you will. So right now, all we have up here to rely on is the ordinances. And if the type of projects you're talking about, Marion, don't require permits or submittals, then you know we're at least I'm not looking at those. So
I would say at this point, just call one of us and ask. Again, it's in the infancy right now, and with the new updates proposed by the state with this ITP project, they're going after rehabilitated projects in landscapes. So there will be forthcoming regulations on that. We just collectively don't know how to address it yet. If there's not an existing permit on the property already, or whatever your renovation is going to do will trigger a building permit or some kind of a construction permit that would then bring in a landscape review. So I think at this point, just call us.
I think the county's approach is very, I mean, that's a good start. I like what Dave was alluding to there. It may be something that, you know, other jurisdictions should start to look at.
I have a question going back to the coarse sediment. And it was explained to me that there's kind of three layers that are involved there, and that's slope, soil, and vegetation. So, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I was just wondering what we can do as a practice, mainly on the vegetation end, to address that or to aid in those strategies specifically for coarse sediment.
Okay, so when the critical coarse sediment yield areas are identified, that's going to be identified by the engineer preparing the stormwater management plan. So there's detailed guidance in the BMP design manual for the county on how to identify those areas. Once you identify those areas, you don't really touch them so they're protected. You don't touch them, you don't re-landscape them. So you're not going to have to figure out how to landscape critical coarse sediment yield areas. They're just kind of protected at that point. So they're kind of off limits. So if you have a slope or something, anything within your project footprint isn't going to be subject to those requirements beyond if you have that area draining through your project in a swale or something. The engineer is going to have to identify what drainage structures are going to need to be in place to convey that sediment through the site. Did I answer your question? So the question is, what about rehabilitation of existing restoration projects?
I mean, it doesn't happen in those areas like
right. At that point, I'm not sure about that. I can't give you an answer on that.
So going back to that, if there is a project, hypothetically, that had that, and you know they're already governed in, but there is some coarse sediment on it. Is there a way to mitigate for that, or to at least account for it, and provide you know another means for doing that?
If the project has critical coarse sediment yield impacts, there are mitigation strategies by balancing the flow out by in that lanes diagram. If you remove the sediment, you can also remove some of the flow. So that's one avenue. Another avenue is to actually put sand at the end of your pipe so that it's being supplied to the stream. They're kind of awkward solutions, but there's a couple out there. Those are kind of two of them. Most of it is just kind of don't touch it. is most of the thing. But if you do have an impact on it, there are mitigation strategies. But that's going to be more on your engineer and how they design it as far as the way you landscape it. It's not going to really impact you. And as far as how to landscape a rehabilitated area, I'll look into that and see what the process is.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
So are we going to see more plant lists that become more critical all the time, and more questions seem to be asked by the stormwater folks about what plants work and what plants don't? And although I like to think of myself as somewhat of an expert on plants, I would, from what I've seen coming out of other agencies, Regional Water Quality Control Board, they have very limited lists of what might go into these kind of places. And I guess I'm looking for some way that we can be more creative with how we put plants in these places, understanding that they have to take harder, you know, harder life. They're going to be beat up by, you know, I guess what I fear is seeing, if I was to use the short list of plants that they liked at the Regional Water Quality Control Board, we're going back to looking like asphalt almost. I mean, it's not a good thing. And I'm wondering how, I guess my real question is, how much will you rely on landscape architects to tell you that the plants we're proposing should work? I mean, at what point is this something that needs to be debated around going over somebody's head about what I can plant in a various place?
I actually want to ask a clarifying question. Are you talking about specific plants for BMPs, or are you talking about plants in somebody's front yard?
Oh, no, I'm talking about plants for BMPs.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
Yes. I was trying to meet the BMP guidelines and still do it with a greater palette, if that's possible, because the palettes I've seen have not been conducive to higher design kind of things. And it sounds like I'm going to have bioswales everywhere. So I guess there's my question. Is there some board of appeal? Is there other people with lists we can use?
Okay, so this is a good question, Joe. So this is going to be part of the threading that you're going to need to really start talking with your stormwater engineer right off the bat with your projects, because the landscaping plans and the stormwater plans are going to be more integrated. We have a couple things that we're building in with dispersion areas, with tree wells, and with bioretention that you're going to need to collaborate with them in the beginning so that you have a complete design. These two design processes are very closely tied together. So for instance, dispersion areas have amended soil to them. You're gonna have to work closely with them to make sure you have the right specification on that, as well as those are planted correctly. And the engineers need to know what areas are being landscaped so they can direct water to those areas. And then you need to know where they're directing water so you can put the right plant there, right? So it's gonna be a lot of back and forth between hopefully you can minimize that, but you are going to have to work closely together on how you design your site so that you put the plants in the right place. Now, as far as what trees and what plants you want to put in bioretention, we've put together a partial list in the county BMP design manual of plants for bioretention devices. Now, this is where your professional judgment comes in and your own research comes in, too, is seeing there's a couple different zones within a bioretention device. You got the bottom where it's staying wet all the time, you got the side slopes, and then you got up high, right? So you have to use your professional judgment on what type of plant is gonna do well in that situation.
Okay.
So it is a lot of it's gonna come back to your professional judgment and what's gonna work there, what's gonna survive in that environment.
And the engineers are going to listen to us, is what you're telling me. No, please, I just had to put that in.
A couple of years ago, this ASLA group did a talk about those plants, and I think at the time they were calling it bioswales. I don't know if you attended that, but
I think I have.
And they produced a list of plant material, which I'm referring to quite a lot already. I have that list. Just a thought.
No, it's a great place to start. I guess I was hoping there was some way this could keep expanding. In a world where we can't have lawns, I'm using some kind of native grasses that kids might walk on. We need more plants, not less, I guess, is the only real comment I'm making.
So one of the things we're finding is that in biofiltration and these stormwater devices, as engineers, we want to maximize our evapotranspiration so that we can minimize the device, right? So we're finding that higher water use plants do better in these devices. And it kind of makes sense because you're trying to get rid of water, you're trying to plant a plant that's going to use that water and uptake it, and it can do well in a saturated situation. So actually, turf does really well in a bioretention system, or it can do really well, but you got to select the right turf, right, so it can be soggy.
Right.
So there is that opportunity. Now, if you're going to put a small turf area in your yard, to maybe dip that down and coordinate with your engineer to say, hey, put your bioretention here. So that's where the communication comes in, as far as then you have a bioretention with a high water use turf grass in it, evaporating a lot of water out of it, and that's going to be much more effective than if you put your bioretention in the back with a low water use native plant that's going to be underwater all the time, and it's going to get root rot and it's not going to live.
Yeah. So I'm going to jump in on this real quick. We have Susie from Village Nurseries here, and she we asked her to be on the panel, and then she said, no, I don't want to be up there because it's not about plants, and suddenly it's about plants. But Susie has developed some really great lists for our profession, and does a lovely tour showing those. So feel free to reach out to her. And then Nick has a
And the list from the previous event is up on the stewardship website. All the presentations and all the plant lists are up there, so you can reference those.
Hi. Nick Martin, landscape architect. I have several questions. One is, Ken was mentioning something about a liner put into bioswales and bioretention areas, that I'm confused by that, because a non-permeable liner would suggest that the water can't filtrate into the subsoil, and I'm just doesn't make sense to me. The second question is, can a landscape architect get certified through the auditor program and audit other projects that they did not design themselves through their own firm? Maybe I should go to the third question that Chris mentioned. Soil moisture sensors are mandatory now for projects, including residential projects over 5,000 square feet. And I don't know if I heard that correctly or not either.
Moisture or DT, you gotta pick one.
Okay.
Soil moisture sensor is given the same, I think, weight as a DT evapotranspiration sensor.
Yep.
Whether it be on-site, off-site, you have to have some sort of a weather climate sensing device or a soil moisture device to shut off and prevent over irrigation.
Is it either or?
It's either or, yeah.
Oh.
The way we understand it, yes.
Great, thank you.
Thank you for clarifying.
So for the first question on a liner for biofiltration areas, oftentimes that is required due to geotechnical concerns. For example, if you have a bioretention area next to a building where they don't want water seeping into underneath the footing, or it's adjacent to a roadway, you don't want the water seeping in under the roadway, could undermine the roadway. So in some cases, a liner is required. In that case, you'd have your soil treatment profile underlain by a gravel subdrain layer with a perforated subdrain pipe that would collect the treated water that's filtered through the soil and then discharge it to the storm drain system, so you wouldn't have standing water within the liner. But so those are in cases where it's infeasible to do infiltration. So if it's feasible to do infiltration and the soil conditions allow for it, then the preference is to have an open bottom with no liner, or perhaps a liner on the sides to prevent water from migrating horizontally, and if possible. But that's going to require coordination with a geotechnical engineer, and geotechnical geotechnical engineers, in my experience, are a very risk-averse group, so that might be a hard sell in some cases.
Was there one more question that you had there that didn't quite get answered yet?
The auditor question.
The auditor question. You guys, we addressed
that. I just had one more comment on the previous question, actually, before we move on. I was just thinking about the lack of diversity of plants for all these bioretention areas and the fact that they need to be high water use, and that our water calculations are telling us to use low water use plants. I'm wondering if for the next time they review the water ordinance, perhaps they might put these bioretention or infiltration areas into special landscape area category, and then you kind of get credit for having that. It might be a good idea, and then it would meet the stormwater needs as well as our landscape needs, perhaps. Just a thought. Sorry, back to the question.
No, that's a great point, and I think there is still a comment period that's going on right now that Chris was mentioning. Do you want to have the date on that?
The next revisions to this is being reviewed by the Independent Technical Review Panel, and the public comment period is currently active until the 13th, which is, I think, Sunday, possibly?
Next week.
Is it next week?
No.
No, that's today is the 10th, so 3 days from now, so you got to get your comments in quickly. We will, short of giving you the person of the Department of Water Resources email, which I can do if you want to see me on the way out, because that's the person you actually do send the comments to. We really do encourage the industry's comments. I mean, if you think about how many comments there are, there's only there was a dozen last time I looked, and I think, you know, it's been a week, so, you know, maybe there's a couple dozen, but we're not getting a lot of, you know, personal comments. It's all just, you know, industry comments. You know, I don't know if ASLA is commenting, but I know ASIC is. I think, okay. So ASLA may be commenting, but we encourage your direct comments as well, because what we talk about right now is kind of where it is now. They're taking it further down the road as well, so it'd be good to stay current on what they're talking about. And the other thing I wanted to comment on is it related to the irrigation auditor. We can, if anybody is interested, we can post the certified irrigation auditors to the IA. There are quite a few of them in the county, and several of them would love to be for hire on that. Not all of us are, but some would be for hire. And the other thing is, there was a consideration of using the EPA WaterSense partners that have completed either, you know, a CLCA water manager exam, the QUEL, Qualified Water Efficient Landscaper, or the G3 Watershed-wise landscape professional program. So currently, I think it's depending on each agency as to what they're accepting. I've talked to some, and they say it needs to be a CLIA certification, but others are contemplating other things to open it up a little bit more. So we can get you a list and perhaps a link as well for the comment period on the website, that it's going to be in the same page as these slides. So,
thank you. Yeah, we'll include that in with the slide presentation when we upload those.
Can I
bring in that last question of whether he could be an auditor or?
No, not Nick. Not at all.
Why would team up?
Again, I think the primary concern is that you're not auditing your own projects, or the contractors aren't auditing their own projects. So, yes, if you have the qualifications, I think anyone could do that.
Any other questions? Just raise your hand. Kathleen?
I have a question about the native plant use, and I know that the city of San Diego had an issue with some of their drainage areas and native plants coming in and creating habitat, and then they could not clear drainage areas for flood control, or they had to get permit for flood control. with the use of all these natives, I think it's a great idea, but are we potentially also creating habitat, and will that hurt our projects or could influence our projects down the line?
That's an interesting question. I would say in areas that are going to be a naturalized condition that is habitat-oriented, that we'd have to look at that carefully, but in contrived situations like the flow-through planters and stuff where natives are being used, that would not be considered
but
that way.
Where the city used it, I mean, these are concrete drainage swales that you see when you ride a trolley that I always thought was just a concrete drainage basin. Mm-hmm. They are technically also little rivers, and concrete where the soil builds up and it establishes habitat.
Yes, and wetlands are their own beast.
So we're creating bioswales that could technically, if we're using native plants, become
habitat, even in an
urban setting, which is what happened with the city. These are very urban environments where the city had an issue with drainage.
The bioswale type of stuff that we're seeing with development, one of the things I think we need to understand is that depending on the water that's being applied to the setting is going to influence how much water is in that soil media. And the list that were put together initially, we're thinking, oh, plants that like to be underwater all the time. Well, in Southern California, our flow-through planters are frequently going to be very dry, as a matter of fact. And with a porous soil mix, we're looking at having drought-tolerant plant material used in those because we know they aren't going to be wet all the time. But the key there is, can they take the inundation on the occasion that it is wet? So it's still evolving for us as well. What you're talking about in terms of being a major drainage system, that's beyond what we look at in terms of private development, typically. And I don't have an answer for you.
I guess I'd throw this question back to Ken. I think some of these areas, if they're subject to a water quality management plan, I mean, they're designed and meant for a certain function, not for habitat, not for restoration.
Your habitat is coming in. That's what I'm saying. You're creating an environment that is encouraging habitat, and then all of a sudden, an area that was just supposed to be used for stormwater management is actually now a habitat that has to go through CEQA in order to have any modifications, which includes plant material in order to keep the flow going.
That's what I'm saying. I think that you have to look at the bigger picture. Maybe those areas, because of the way they were planned and engineered, you know, that would exempt them from those sorts of qualifications.
So typically with on projects where you have these stormwater BMPs and a stormwater management plan, there will be a maintenance agreement associated with that, and that requires the project to upkeep these treatment areas regularly, and they have to file reports with the governing agency as well to show that they're compliant with that maintenance agreement. And so I think, I'm no expert on native habitat, but I think that regular maintenance would likely prevent it from becoming like a jurisdictional wetland or a habitat area.
I can comment on that. Just having had done a lot of the restoration projects, what happens is basically the maintenance is supposed to be done so that your riparian plants don't get above a certain diameter at breast height. And when that does happen, that's what triggers it and makes it habitat and not just the stormwater. And what has happened with the city, because they haven't had the money or they haven't allocated the money to maintain these places that they are supposed to maintain every year, that's what has put the city in this situation, is it's the lack of maintenance that the city has ignored. And that's why these stormwater areas are now riparian corridors. I do want to
let you guys know we're kind of hitting our time limit. We're going to have one more question here, and then we'll invite you to eat some more of the refreshments and network. And then the venue, which has been gracious enough to sponsor us, has asked that we're out by 5 o'clock. So one last question.
Apologize if this has already been discussed, but for rehabilitated landscape areas that are installing hardscape, mostly for residential, what would trigger the need for a BMP or a bioswale? Is it a certain size or permits or?
Yes. So so in our permit is written in the criteria, if you will, for a priority development project. And the thresholds, and Ken was talking about those in his presentation, is 10,000 square feet of impervious cover unless you're a certain use, which is a gas station, a retail store, and there's one other one that's 5,000 square feet of impervious cover. And if you're in an environmentally sensitive area in ESA, it's 2,500 square feet. And remind me again, for redevelopment, I believe it's 5,000 square feet. So that those would be the thresholds that are triggered for development type projects that would trigger a need to do some sort of stormwater control on site.
What about for residential?
Well, same thing for residential. I'll give you an example. My neighbor across the street just paved over his entire front yard. And the city, he got the city's attention, I'll put it that way, because he didn't get a permit.
So over 10,000?
For redevelopment, it's over 5,000 square feet.
5,000.
Yeah, and it is written in the NPDES permit, too.
That's of an impervious area, so
yes.
It's just landscaping that.
Right.
Talk to your civil engineer, too.
Do we have any opportunity for us to comment?
Yes.
Really quickly.
3 minutes.
First of all, I wanted to applaud Ken on a really good presentation on a really complex permit, because he did a great job. And I did want to add one small caveat on the hydro modification stuff. This goes back to the planning aspect. We developed water quality improvement plans during the first 2 years of the planning process of this permit, and part of that WQIP was the development of the watershed management area analysis, which looked at, among other things, the hydro modification exemptions. This is important because if your water quality improvement plan isn't approved and accepted by the regional board, which all of ours in the region except for one are, you don't get your hydro modification exemptions. So if you're going to be looking at doing any big projects in the Carlsbad watershed, you really need to talk to the jurisdictions in that watershed, because they're still having to redevelop their water quality improvement plan. And that means the hydro modification exemptions are not in effect for that watershed, and that's important for development. And the other comment, so good job. You did a great job. That's a complex permit to have to interpret, especially if you're not dealing with it every day like Stuart and I are. So the other thing is Chris, where'd Chris go? Chris did a really great job on his presentation too. But one of the things I want to ask, because I have the attention of a room full of landscape architects and landscape professionals, is why is stormwater still being considered as an augmentation or an ancillary use? If you look at the policies that are coming down from the state, we're now having grant funding tied to stormwater capture for use projects. In other words, we have to now, we're in the second phase of our planning for the county, we're developing stormwater resource plans that are requiring us to develop a prioritized list of quantified stormwater capture for use projects. And we're not going to get any grant funding from any bond measure unless we have a project on that list. So, you know, the state is really tying our hands, and they're really looking for all of us to utilize stormwater as a beneficial use as opposed to getting rid of it as a nuisance from now on. So I would encourage us, in a room full of, you know, landscape professionals, to look at stormwater maybe as one of your primary sources of water as opposed to a secondary option. And then let's look at using the applied water secondarily so we can maintain those conservation measures and offset the need for potable use. I think that's the way to start looking, and that's that paradigm shift that we need to be having. And that does the tie-in between our landscaping and our stormwater controls that are needed.
And that was it. Did you have any?
That was great.
Was that great? Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Just one quick comment, and I mentioned this before, and I'll say it again. Talk to your civil engineer. I'm glad Ken's here. I see too many projects where landscape architects and civil engineers are not communicating. We need to step up. We've got landscape architects that are unaware that basins are lined. They're planting trees in them. What happens? You have to stake trees. You end up with stakes through liners. We've got landscape architects proposing impervious areas where there's already been a WQMP for the project or stormwater calcs for basin sizing, and you throw it in impervious area, that throws those calcs off. So please talk to your civil engineer.
Thank you so much. A round of applause for our presenters and our panelists. And another big thanks to our sponsors. Without our sponsors, these events would not happen. Mark from Bellegarde, thank you. And Chris with Hunter, thank you. And just one last reminder, all the presentations and the video will be available on the ASLA stewardship website. So please take a look at that. There is a wealth of resources also on that website from previous events. And oh, you will be getting an evaluation in your email within the next few minutes, hopefully. It's just 4 questions. If you could take the time to send the feedback, we'd greatly appreciate it. That's how we continually see improve these events and have hold events with, that are topics that are pertinent to you. So thank you very much. And thank you for the stewardship committee. You guys always rock the house. Thanks.